What's going on, horror fans? Welcome back to another episode of Slashing Cast. My name is Riley.
My name is Nick.
Oh, and today we got a juicy one for you. This episode of Slash Cast is brought to you by Manscaped, but we'll talk about that a little bit later in this episode. But first of all, man, let's ride in. We got some announcements first. Not really announcements, but things I got to let you know about.
Obviously, we just had a Friday the 13th. And the Slashcast Podcast Network all celebrated. There were so many episodes that were Friday the 13th franchise reviews. Definitely go and check all those out. And a quick way to find out is going to the slashingcast.net website.
Yeah, a lot of everything's on there. Like, you got videos, you got the podcast network, you got the Fall Camp Blood. Everything's on the website. Head over there.
Merch.
Hey, and if you're not already a member of the channel, consider joining for as low as $2 to get exclusive content. New vlog just came out this morning. Pretty juicy one, let me tell you. Spoiler alert, I put my hand into a bowl of chicken. Think about it. You want to see it. I know.
I kind of want to see it.
All right, let's dive into our first topic of the day. Scream 5. A lot of juicy things have been happening with Scream 5, but just today, literally today, assuming that this releases on November 17th, Scream 5 has officially wrapped on filming. This is it. 14 months before its planned release of January 2022. Yeah, I was like, what year is it, bro? 2022. Yeah, they already wrapped on filming, so plenty of time to edit. Shouldn't have any issues over there. And apparently, based on what David Arquette said during the Scream virtual reunion, the cast bonded extremely well. They got along like it was the OG, man. And hopefully that translates well to camera. It usually does. Mm-hmm. All around, very excited, though. Scream 5 is wrapped on filming. We got another one on the way. It seems like it's a long ways away, but now there's potential that the release date may change. If they're this done with it, you know, then you don't need 14 months to edit a movie.
That's true.
Especially a slasher movie. So we'll see what happens there. But on topic of that virtual Scream reunion, which was very cool, by the way, to see all of them back together again like that. It was wild. But for the most part, they stayed pretty quiet in terms of Scream 5. They didn't want to spoil anything. But Kevin Williams did come out and he did give us a little bit of details throughout the stream.
Right. So he said, and I quote, "No deconstruction, no self-awareness, just the opposite of what we did. I do worry that the franchise kind of wears itself out with all the meta and the deconstruction, and there's only so many times you can do it. So many people have since done horror films like it, or in the vein of. So you do worry that it kind of runs its course," end quote.
Which, based on that quote from Kevin Williamson, it begs the question, where are they going with this Scream? Scream is known for being meta. That's, you know, the original Scream made fun of horror movies, the sequel made fun of sequels, the third one made fun of trilogies, the fourth one made fun of reboots. Now, where are we at here?
He says no self-awareness. I hope that's like a misquote. Hopefully there's still some, maybe just not full on, because in that case, Scream 5 is just going to be something completely different than we know and love, and I don't know how us fans are going to respond to that.
Yeah, you know, for there to be no self-awareness, it kind of goes back to that rumor train where Scream 5 might be Wes Craven's New Nightmare type of thing, where none of the movies actually happened and we're not actually following Nev, Gale, and Dewey, but we're following David, Nev, or Sydney is what I meant. We're following David, Nev, and Courtney. So I don't know what actually is happening, but that's interesting. I don't know how, because like, you can't take away the self-awareness of the OG cast. I don't know.
Yeah, hopefully that was just a misquote. Hopefully it's more like not as much, but like, that's why we love Scream so much.
Right. Yeah. Who knows what he actually means by that quote. But the thing is, though, he went on, if that makes you nervous, he went on to say something that shouldn't make you nervous. Quote, "I'm blown away by the directors, and I was really nervous because nobody is Wes Craven. I was really hesitant to even jump on board and be a part of it, and boy, am I glad I did, because I think it's going to make Wes proud," end quote. See, if you're going to say something like that, I mean, I think they'll be all right.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not too worried if that's Kevin's thought process going into this thing.
Yeah, definitely glad that that Kevin Williamson's on board, you know, to, you know, he's been there through it all.
Yeah, he has, man, except for the third one, which is why it's probably a disaster to most people anyway. But yeah, you know, they had to make a bit of a comeback in terms of how Scream 4 did at the box office. And that's why I would assume they're stepping away a little bit from the formula, because that formula has been replicated so many times. I mean, you literally just look at the teen slasher genre. That was all just pulled from Scream. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, we'll see where they go with it. Also in the stream, one last thing from Kevin here. He still has the mask that Ghostface wore in Tatum's death scene in the OG. And he said that it'll make an appearance somewhere in Scream 5. Will it be on a person? I doubt it, but who knows?
Yeah, that's cool, I guess. I mean, yeah, if we never were told that, we just, you know, saw the mask and we wouldn't think anything of it. But that's pretty cool.
Yeah, I mean, I don't even know how you'd be able to tell. It's just a ghost face mask.
Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah. All right. Moving on to our next topic, an interesting one. A couple of Friday the 13th topics here for you. Jason Takes Manhattan for the first time ever is being brought to vinyl. So this was in celebration of Friday the 13th, which of course just happened a few days ago. Waxwork once again coming in clutch, and they're dropping the Jason Takes Manhattan vinyl bomb, which is unreal, bro, because it's been a long time.
Right. Waxwork Records is thrilled to release the complete score for the very first time on vinyl. Sourced from the original master tapes from Paramount's vaults, the score has been restored and remastered. The album package features 180-gram colored vinyl, an interactive die-cut old-style tip-on gatefold jackets with matte satin coating, printed inner sleeves, and new artwork by Anthony Petri.
And she's beautiful too, man. I mean, she is about as pretty as it gets. Something I wanted. I want it. I want it a lot.
You want to go grab it?
Yeah, I want to go grab it.
Well, it's already sold out.
Nah, well. Waxworks always sells out so fast. But it was only $40, but I guarantee you're going to have resellers on this thing. And if you want to get it now, you're probably looking closer to like $70, maybe a little bit more.
It's beautiful art.
Yeah, it's pretty dope, man. Then you have, I like the vinyls themselves are super cool. You got Jack-O-Lantern Jason on there, and you have the I Heart New York. So, all around, super cool set. Waxwork always delivers in terms of those. So, I'm really, really happy that they're the ones taking on Part 8. Yeah. First time ever on vinyl. That's hard to believe, man. First time ever Part 8 comes to vinyl. And, of course, Part 8's the first time Harry Manfredini is not actually credited as the composer, because they moved away from the strings for Part 8, and they went to the synth, you know, the right. 80s synth that you know and love. And yeah, that's probably why I never came to vinyl right there. And here we are, all these years later. I can't wait for it. All right, before we move on to our next topic, got a shout out to today's sponsor, Manscaped. Listen, if you are struggling, you know, you're a big, thick boy. You know, you don't have to be thick. Just a big, just a boy, really. Not even necessarily that, really. You can do whatever you want, man. The Perfect Package 3.0 is for everybody. If you're looking for the perfect gift for your partner this holiday season, or perhaps you just have a buddy who you think has some ball issues, because I know I got a couple. I got one probably right in front of me. I might toss one his way. We got the Perfect Package for his perfect package. The Perfect Package 3.0 by Manscaped is the number one recommended gift all year long. I got mine right here. Look at this. Look at this bag. This bag alone is worth the price, you know what I'm saying? Yes. But of course, it comes with the Lawnmower 3.0, which has a freaking light on it. Do you see that? Huh? God damn. It's the best men's below-the-belt grooming trimmer, which can be used on any part of the body, all right? So don't just focus on the testes. I mean, the testes are important. Clean yourself up down there, all right? But you could, of course, safely use it anywhere on your body. You got a hairy chest, you got a hairy back. Hey. No problem there, man. You got the hair in your way down in the testy area? No problem. Manscaped Lawnmower 3.0 is designed to make sure you get reduced cuts and makes for a nice smooth trim. This 7,000 RPM trimmer has helped reduce manscaping accidents around the world. And in addition to that, you'll find other liquid formulations inside the perfect package, like their Crop Preserver Ball Deodorant, which is a God's gift to humanity. by the way. If you, again, if you're, if you got the big old thighs like your boys do, all right, yes, it is a gift, man. You're sick of chafing all the time? Get the goddamn Crop Reserver Ball Deodorant, all right? You also got the Crop Reviver Ball Toner and Reduced Chafing Boxer Briefs, which I'm wearing right now. I'd show you, but I don't think you want to see that. But I got, they're extremely comfortable, man. And of course, these formulations are all vegan, cruelty-free, dye-free, sulfate-free, and paraben-free. So, you know your manhood is in good hands. Save 20% off and get free shipping with the code SLASH at checkout at manscaped.com. Hey, give your testies the besties, my friends, with Manscaped. All right, head over to manscaped.com, use code SLASH at checkout, 20% off your order and free shipping. Thanks again to Manscaped for sponsoring today's video, and I'm sure, hopefully, you'll hear a lot more from them in the future. Absolutely love them. With that, let's move on to our next topic. Mezco coming in clutch, all right, reissuing a Part 3 figure. This Part 3 figure is one I don't have, so I'm super glad that they're making this thing happen. They kicked off the Friday the 13th a few days ago by reissuing the Jason Voorhees figure. This was part of their 112 collective line, which is also amazing. I have the Michael Myers one. I have the Ash from Evil Dead 2 one. And I've gotta scoop this one as well.
The 6-inch figure includes two menacingly detailed head portraits and two removable hockey masks. Jason's axe accessory fits nearly into the gash on his wounded head, as well as the crack in his hockey mask, recreating the iconic finale from Friday the 13th Part 3. The infamous Crystal Lake Killer is outfitted authentically from the film. Jason comes complete with every weapon he used in the film: an axe, a machete, a cleaver, a wrench, a fireplace poker, a knife, and a spear gun.
Yeah, so it's no joke, man. You got every little thing right there for you. Super cool figure. And like I said, Mezco always delivers on those 112 figures. So scoop it while you can. You can pre-order it now today for $85 and expect it to be shipped in May, July 2021. Don't miss out, because when they sell out again, bro, they're going to sell for big money. All of those 112 figures do. So yes, get out there. All right, moving on to our next topic of the day. Dark Pictures Anthology has already teased their next game. So, I mean, Little Hope just came out, right? Which was cool. I haven't finished it yet. I'm going to dive into it, and we're going to go through the whole thing. But, yeah, Little Hope just dropped, and it did, I mean, it definitely did better than Man of Medan, and people are really enjoying that side of it. And it's, the witches are creepy, man. I don't know what to tell you. It was a scary time. But now in that game, they snuck in a teaser for the next entry called House of Ashes. And now they've confirmed that it's coming to PlayStation 5, the Xbox Series X, PlayStation 4, Xbox One, and PC in 2021. So really not that far away already. They're making quick turns over there, man. Like they're dropping a lot of games. Now, here's the story. Take all this in. This is not what I expected at all when I heard the title, so this is pretty wild. Iraq, 2003. So we all know what's going on then in Iraq, all right? As the conflict draws to a close, CIA field operative Rachel King joins an elite military unit on a raid of a suspected underground chemical weapons facility in the shadow of the Zagros Mountains. Arriving at the coordinates, the unit is ambushed by a local patrol led by Sergeant Salem Othman. During the battle, an earthquake opened sinkholes in the ground, pitching both sides into the ruins of a buried Sumerian temple. In the darkness beneath the Arabian desert, something evil is awakened. Savage and unstoppable, a nest of ancient and unearthly creatures has a new prey to hunt. I mean, you want to talk about unique in terms of a horror game? I never would have thought that in one of these creepy-ass single-player type horror games, I'd be going to Iraq in 2003 in the middle of the war on terror.
Right, that's more of a Call of Duty story there.
Yeah, if you watch the teaser as well, you're going in there and you're shooting shit. I mean, yeah. I highly doubt there's any moments in the game where you are shooting anybody. Maybe you use your guns or you on whatever you think this evil thing is and they don't work. But other than that, I don't think you're ever going to see those guns get used. But they'll be in cutscenes, I guess. Which, I mean, that's pretty much what these games are. I mean, you're playing them, right? But they're movies. And the whole time, you're getting unique camera-type angles as you're controlling. Which, in Man of Medan, I found to be pretty frustrating. Because when you're going to the ship, you can't angle it right, and you get confused and you get lost all the time. But it's basically just playing a horror movie. So really curious where they go with House of Ashes. How about it? I got to finish Little Hope, but I'm digging it. All right, last topic of the day, A Quiet Place 3 has already been confirmed. I can't believe it. So Deadline reported that Paramount has hired Jeff Nichols, who did Midnight Special, to write and direct a third installment in the franchise, which will release in theaters in 2022. We haven't even got the second one yet, but a third one apparently is on the way.
The site adds that the third movie storyline is based on an original idea by John Krasinski. Krasinski, who wrote and directed the first two movies, is also on board to produce the third.
Yeah. And again, the second one hasn't even come out, but
right.
Whatever. Producers also include Michael Bay, Andrew Form, and Brad Fuller from Platinum Dunes. Maybe that's a good thing. It depends on the day. Like I said, man, Quiet Place 2 is still currently set for release on April 23rd, 2021. It obviously got delayed because of COVID and the pandemic. We're going to have two kind of back-to-back Quiet Place movies. I do think it's interesting that John Krasinski is not going to be writing and directing the third one, and why, before you even see any sort of feedback from the second one, why he already made that choice to step down.
Yeah, that is interesting. You know, maybe his story was two parts and money talks and he'll produce the third one, I guess.
Yeah, I guess so. I don't know. It's definitely interesting stepping down, but I'm not going to dig too deep into it. All right. I'm just going to assume that he's like, yeah, you know, whatever. He's still producing, so obviously he still has faith in the story. And Jeff Nichols also is very talented too. So he passed to a good buddy. Let's say that. Passed to a good buddy. Alright, well, that is this episode of Slash and Cast. Let us know your thoughts on all the topics of today in the comments below. If you're listening, thanks for listening. If you're watching, thanks for watching. Because if you didn't know, this show is also available on all podcast platforms. So if you just want to listen to our voices rather than seeing our ugly faces, you can do just that. Huh? Hey, and thanks again to Manscaped for sponsoring this episode. Make sure you go check out the Perfect Package 3.0. Help out a fellow buddy of yours out there. Maybe a partner, maybe a buddy. Help them get clean shaven out there. All over the body. Huh? Use code slash checkout. 20% off. Free shipping. That's all I got, folks. With that, as always, thank you guys so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.